Good evening, everyone. Thank you for coming this evening to our Goostree Lectures Series. Thank you. How many of you, is first time you've been to one of Dr. Fleming's presentations? All right. Several of you here the first time. Well, you're going to be blessed tonight and really some new learning opportunities as well. Just a few words of instruction for you, those of you new this evening, first time with us. There are restrooms outside my door to the right. Men's is straight ahead. Women's to the left down the hallway. We have lots of cheesecake back there. Nobody leaves until we finish it all tonight. We have fruit top and coffee and so forth, so enjoy. Get up anytime, go back and get some refreshments or restroom break. Let's see, the series tomorrow again. We come back together at noon tomorrow for luncheon. It's a $6 luncheon tomorrow, and we have a buffet set up for you, and it'll be a wonderful meal catered by our own kitchen. Tomorrow evening we have dinner, and that will be another buffet, so you get to eat buffets all next to noons and evenings if you want. And then we have an exercise class that starts right after that, early next week, so you'll be able to partake of that. But come and join us for as many as you can. You'll be blessed. Everyone's unique and different. And we're so grateful to have Dr. Fleming with us again this evening. Dr. Brewster is going to say a word of introduction and welcome as well.
Sure. Just a quick word. There are materials at the back that are Dr. Fleming's books and teaching materials that you will find very helpful. If you teach at all, you'll find great resources there that you can use in your teaching. And I do want to just say welcome again, Jim. Thank you for this morning, and thanks for being with us, all that you're doing. Jim travels a lot, speaks a lot. You've had an opportunity to read his bio and to hear about it. I just want to add that he is very special to a lot of people who have had the opportunity to travel with him and to experience the land with Jim as a guide. There really is no experience quite like that, to have the opportunity to be there and to experience that. And I know Jim is still leading trips, and there's probably information back there, Jim, about that. If you are interested in actually traveling to the land with Jim. And in fact, we may look at doing that as a church with him. And so if you can, if you're interested in that, please let me or let Chuck know about that. And we can think about that, but or investigate that, find out how to go about that. But again, welcome to you all. Glad that you're here. And Jim, welcome again to you. We were reminiscing a little bit at lunch about Jim's dogs. Jim is a dog lover, as we are. Especially, he appreciates Cocker Spaniels. And a particular Cocker Spaniel that he had, I remember a number of years ago, Jim named his dog a name that would hardly fit on the registration paperwork. Now, you know, Jeff Foxworthy's, you might be a redneck if. Okay, you might be a biblical scholar if you name your dog Tiglath-Pileser III. But he did find that saying, here, Tiglath-Pileser III, was a little long, so he called him Tiggy for short. But anyway, Jim, welcome. Yeah, glad you're here.
I think I'm using. Okay. Thank you, Tim, very much. Our students had a hard time remembering the name of the Assyrian who came down like a wolf on the fold in the book of Isaiah in 731. So that's why he named the dog Tiglath-Pileser III, so the students would remember his name. Well, this morning, those of you in the morning service, we began introducing the notion of how the biblical mind, you understand a revelation, a God who is revelatory, who is believed to be self-disclosing things about God in our world. You don't do that the way the Greeks did abstractly, but you recall what God has done, and the name of our lecture for tonight. Before I begin, may I ask you to picture a tree that you really like, a kind of a tree. There's not a right or wrong answer. picture a tree that you like. And if you don't mind, a few of you telling me why you like it. It's not a right or wrong. Who picks a tree? Tell me why you like that tree. Someone brave? Just yes.
So I like this tree. It's almost two trees together. It's almost like two people are back to back, and each one has arms reaching out on either side.
Do you know the kind of tree it is? Just curious.
I believe it's a live oak.
Okay, live oak. Two-person live oak tree. Okay, someone else? Yeah.
In my front yard, I have a tree that comes together that people have stopped and rang my doorbell to know how I grafted that tree together. Well, I bought the tree. It's a crape myrtle that's pink on one side and purple on the other side. People in my neighborhood that meet me and find out where I live, they say, oh, you live where the pink and the purple tree is.
Okay.
It just happened. I mean, I guess I have no idea how it happened, but it's...
Well, I imagine you have more visitors when the tree is in bloom than in autumn. Okay. Someone else, why you like a particular kind of tree?
Sugar maple.
Sugar maple? Maple?
Sugar.
You like maple sugar. Okay. Yes?
Pecan tree, because it's our state tree. It grows a long, long time, lives a long time, produces fruit, nuts that we like.
Okay.
It grows in places with a lot of water.
All right. Well, listen, there's many other things you could say. Most people picture a tree because we're raised to think visually, because something about it looks very nice and interesting. Like, for example, the cedar of Lebanon is a majestic tree in the Bible. The biblical mind would say what the tree means to me, not necessarily how it looks within itself. So you mentioning the pecan, you mentioning the maple syrup, subject in relation to the tree. Not just the tree within itself. The Bible calls a particular tree beautiful. In the book of Hosea, Israel's likened to the beauty of an olive tree. Well, it's kind of scrawny. It's knotted and twisted. Normally, they're not very high because you keep it pruned to be able to pick the olives. Why would Hosea liken Israel to the beauty of an olive tree? Because what it does. That's what makes it beautiful. Not what it looks like within itself, but what it does. We spoke this morning about what God did through Jesus was important from his life. We don't have any pictures or descriptions, do we, of what Jesus looked like? Not important. What he did is important. Now, the olive tree has wood for olive wood souvenirs on the back table there from Bethlehem. The door of the tree, of the temple, was made of olive wood. But, of course, it had fruit, which could be pickled and eaten. The fruit is coming out this month now of an olive tree. And then the olive oil. Man, look how beautiful this tree is. You not only have the first pressing of oil, which is, remember, the first goes to God. It's for anointing the sick. It's for the oil lamp in your synagogue or the temple. The second pressing, after you cup up the first, is for cooking and eating. You add another weight. The third pressing is a little bit bitter. It's for your oil lamps, for electricity, shall we say. Then the fourth press is full of lye, L-Y-E. It's for palm olive soap. Palm and olive oils were used for soap. But talk about a beautiful tree. Look what it does, you see. It's also a hardy tree and survives where other trees do not not survive. Now, the country that first developed realistic art, other than one exception of some caves in France from the Stone Age that made very realistic herd of animals, painted on the walls. But the, in terms of art that was passed on generation to generation were the Greeks. Jews tend to just say, what is its function? What does it do? Not how to make it look beautiful. The Greeks made things really look beautiful. And amazing what they did in trying to make realistic looking people. You start in Greece with it sort of like in Egypt, where you see both shoulders and both legs. In Egypt, you're walking like this, but there's not perspective or frontal or angle view, only frontal view. We start getting some side views with more serious relief. You see, there's shadow under the chin and jaw. You could begin seeing pectoral muscles of the chest and upper arm. Or more delicately, these are all from the 7th and 6th centuries BC. But by the 500s BC, we get full statues, not just side views. It's still a little bit general. And we start getting paintings on jars. Though it's just two-dimensional being on a jar, we're looking from the side. By the transition from 600 to 500, we get our first statue with the leg forward. Not attention side by side. But you see, you need some work still on the kneecaps, right? It doesn't look super realistic. But look what eventually happens by the end of the 500s and the beginning of the 400s. Really studying the skeleton within a person. So when you have one leg up, the hip goes one way, the shoulders normally go the other way. They were studying the arrangement of muscles in the body. Look at this death mask at a funeral showing someone grieving at the loss of a loved one. The realism of the face. You could almost expect the person to say something to you. Look at the furrowed brow. You can tell they're in grief. You don't necessarily see it in many statues today. This particular one, you can see that the hair had been painted a brown color. Most of the marble statues were actually painted to even look more realistic. Only a few, quote, colors survive, and it's usually it's the reddish-brown ones that help us know that they were painted. But the realism of art. Now, amazing, you guys. We're now into the 400s BC. Cast out of bronze. Look at the flared nostrils of that racing horse. Looks like the little jockey's going to fall off any minute. There was probably a leather leash, which has not survived. But for them, realism was very important for how you have art. And architecture. In Hebrew, you have one word, support. It can be translated pillar, column, stack of rocks. For the Greeks, even the supports of a building should look beautiful, should look artistic. Can you see this is a fluted column with an Ionic capital? Look at this building. This is actually the Parthenon. But can you tell the column goes straight for a while, slightly bulging the third one in, and then it tapers in more. Okay, I want to address this to you guys. If you're getting a bit of a spare tile around your stomach, tell your wife, I'm just looking like a Greek column, slightly bulging in the middle before it goes, tapers in at the top. But it has to look right. Where did this come from? How come other cultures aren't doing that? Maybe it's the beauty of the rugged islands in the Aegean Sea. And maybe being seafaring people that want to adventure to see other lands. This is looking from the Acropolis down to the lower city of Athens. This building from the 400s BC has not been restored. It was so well engineered. And you count the number of columns on the narrow and the long side to make it look good. A square would not look as beautiful as a rectangle. And the proportion is all a part of what they studied to make it look right. Here you can see a colonnaded building on the left. It was excavated by the United States, who actually fully restored it. It's called the Royal Painted Portico of Athens. And you can see a little bit of the Acropolis, the heights of Athens. Now, in a Greek city, you will have pedestals. Most of the statues have not survived. But every road, like on the right side here, is lined with pedestals. Here's a person from one of our trips sitting next to such a pedestal. Usually you make the statues a size and a half, so 8 or 9 feet tall. And they look down at you as you walk. And who's keeping an eye on you? Past philosophers, rulers, city officials. They're always looking at you. And you're supposed to remember them and the values of your community. It was said that it's easier to meet a god in Athens than a person, because there were just statues everywhere. Here we're looking from the Acropolis down to a hill called Mars Hill. It is where there was a dean of faculty to determine who could speak in the market at Athens. This is a bronze plaque, you might imagine, in Greek, of St. Paul's speech to the Mars Hill. The other word is Areopagite of Athens. It's a very interesting speech. Paul does what is called first principles lecture. You have anything but first principles discussions on our news channels. First principles mean, in order to have a good discussion, both sides must say, at what point do we go from agreeing to disagreeing? What first principle can we agree with? And after you've done your first principle, then you can move on to try to understand where your differences came. Paul's first principle talked about how he was walking through Athens and seeing all these statues to gods. And one of the statues said, to the unknown God. And Paul said, I want to speak to you about that God. Can we postulate that the Creator God is the God Most High? They discussed that a while. It takes 10 minutes, 5 minutes to read it, but it probably was an hour or so lecture. Can we postulate the Creator God is the God Most High? And they all agreed, yes. Then he said, that means you could divide the universe into two parts. Creator, created. Can we agree with that? Then he goes on, and this becomes more controversial. These statues are made out of granite and marble. They're created, not creator. Jews and Christians and Muslims believe you don't bow down to created. You bow down only to creator. His next principle was, this God is so great, this God works through history, can disclose things in history, in a human world, and raised prophets long ago to teach us. And they even spoke of a long-awaited promised one who would come. I imagine at that time, his clock, the time was up. Probably had he been invited back, his next one would have been on Christology, that Jesus was that long-awaited promised one. But Paul is trained in rhetoric. There's 22 rules of rhetoric, how you make an argument. Did you know every single one of them is found in the letters of Paul? He was raised in the town of Tarsus, which was noted for its Stoic philosophers and its rhetoric schools. Well, here's the Acropolis. Here's the silhouette of the gateway leading up to it. And there again you see a group. Next January I'm going to be in Athens with a group. It's not, in my mind, the best time of year to go to Athens and Rome, but it's a group of clergy that could only be off in January. So they're all wearing our jackets for that trip. But there you can see some of the colonnade. Did you know that none of those columns are absolutely vertical? 5 miles above the Acropolis, all the columns would point to one spot. Because the Greeks realized if you make them exactly vertical, it will look like they're slightly leaning out. And if you don't make them slightly swell a bit off the ground, it'll look like it begins to get hourglass. And if you don't make the floor slightly bulge in the middle of the building, it's only an inch and a half, from a distance it will look like it slightly sags. Everything in their architecture was to how you make it look right. And even modern buildings in Greek also are often neoclassical. Walking around downtown, I noticed how many neoclassical architectural features Fort Worth has in many of its older buildings. How it looks is important. I'm sorry, I was pressed it too hard, I think. Well, when Alexander the Great came through 332 BC, Jews start asking themselves a question they're still asking today. How Greek can I be and still be Jewish? You ask that question. How secular can I be and still be Christian? The Western world is two streams flowing together, the Greco-Roman and the Judeo-Christian. Judeo-Christian, beauty within. Greco-Roman culture, beauty without. Both are wonderful aspects to our culture. But we're raised in a world that stresses how things look. So, this is a Jewish tomb in Jerusalem, 1st century BC, after Alexander came through. If it were a full copy of a Greek tomb, there would be statues between those four columns. So they left out the offensive part. Remember in Exodus 20, thou shalt make no graven image to bow down and worship it. The word technically is an iconic. Jews were against image. Well, our conference is called Biblical Imagery. And I'm showing you a bunch of pictures to help you understand biblical imagery. But we're going to move from what it looks like to something deeper. What it does. And Jesus was trying to remind John in prison what was important is what God was doing through his ministry. Well, this is a painting from Raphael, Plato, and Aristotle in the school of Athens. And many Jews and most Christians adopted Greek philosophical categories later in the history of the church. Did you know we've actually found Plato's school? On a rock hill, you can see where the roof was anchored. It's described where in Macedonia it was. Guess who one of his students was? Alexander the Great. And it's above a spring. Aristotle taught the nicest atmosphere for studying is where there's some running water nearby. Well, here is a Byzantine-style church. It happens to be St. Paul's outside the walls in Rome. But can you see there's murals on the walls and on the ceiling, and so much art decorates such a church. Most Jewish synagogues in antiquity would not have art, right? That might be imagery. In modern Israel, you could have a human on a shekel, a dollar, on a print, because that's two dimensionals, length and width. It's not volume art like a relief. So they got away with human and animal image on paper money. On a mosaic floor, two dimensions, but not three dimensions. But you might imagine some Jews were so in love with the beauty of Greek art and architecture, they even make some statues, humans and animals. And for them, they stress the second half of Exodus 20, verse 1. Thou shalt make no graven image to bow down and worship it. The image in and of itself, they would feel, is not wrong. But as long as you're not bowing down and worshiping it. So Jews are very divided on that subject. Now the church began to make two-dimensional images in the mosaics on their walls. Do you see how this shepherd with the fleek, with the sheep, how ordered the and balanced the trees and bushes are, how the sheep are equally spaced, etc. But eventually, by the Middle Ages, we start getting some mosaics like this one. Had I been able to have a picture this morning, this is John the Baptist in a mosaic in 1200, in the darkness of his prison cell, that furrowed brow. Are you the one, or should we wait for another? But you see, there's some realism now, a sense of the protruding nose, some shadow, even with some of the cheekbones and under the brows of the eye, etc. Well, of course, by the beginning of the Enlightenment and the Renaissance, then we move into, shall we say, a resurrection of Greco-Roman perspective and art. This is Tintoretto's painting of Christ before Pontius Pilate. I like the way Pilate isn't that interested in Jesus as he's washing his hands. Okay. On page 14 through 16 in the notebook, so on the back, and I hope some of you will get it, for our tonight, tomorrow night, and the next night, all of the pictures will give you page numbers. And this is that notebook. It's a 10-hour conference that was transcribed. There's also some diagrams in the back. And also on the back, there's this booklet, which has over 400 color glossy photos for biblical imagery. Every two pages tells you what it looks like, what it does, and what it means. We have a few churches that have Sunday school classes taking a whole year, taking two pages at a time as list of references and things to try to understand biblical imagery. That notebook, because it's almost 400 color pictures, is normally $39, but because I don't want to carry these heavy notebooks back on my flight, it's going to be $29 back there on the page. In Song of Solomon, we have a beautiful description in verses, in chapters 7 and following, of a lover describing the lovee. How beautiful you are, my darling. To illustrate how you and I are very visual, let your imagination flow as I quote the Song of Solomon describing his love. How beautiful you are, my darling. Your hair is like a flock of goats. Your nose is like the Tower of Lebanon facing Damascus. Your neck is like the Tower of David on which are hung 1,000 shields. Your teeth are like newly cut lambs in a row. Your hair like scarlet thread. Your eyes are like doves behind your veil. Your breasts are like two fawns, twins of a gazelle, grazing amongst the lilies. Your temple is like a slice of pomegranate. Now, I believe you would agree we have to feel sorry for the lover and the lovee if this is description and form, how she looked. Most of the things of that poem are personality characteristics. And if we will ask what each of those things does, not how it looks, we hope, maybe we can get a picture of what she meant to the man speaking of her. That your eyes are like doves behind your veil, does remember, were appropriate for sacrifice. You have innocent eyes. Innocent eyes. Your hair like a herd of goats. It might mean it's long and stringy. Goats tend to not be as clustered as sheep. It might mean it's black hair, which would be the case of most Semites in the past. But it's hard to know for sure what the herd of goat is. That your teeth are like newly shorn sheep, maybe it means they're white. You know, until you cut the wool, it's pretty dirty. Maybe she has just flossed, I don't know. Your temple like a slice of pomegranate. There is a rabbinic saying that someone who's full of ideas is a pomegranate head because of all the seeds, right? Maybe she's full of ideas. Now, we don't really know what the Tower of David looked like. There is this tower in the old city of Jerusalem, which is called the Tower of David. But in the Old Testament period, we don't know what people are associating with a tower they call the Tower of David. If it was a tall, majestic tower, it might point to her poise, and she walks with her shoulders back and her chin up. If it's a short, fat tower like this one, it might mean, boy, can she haul water. But you understand, for the biblical mind, you don't just think what it looks like. You know, some scholars say there's not one Western description in the entire Bible to let you know what something looked like. Now, just a cotton-picking minute, you know, that's an ancient Hebrew expression, by the way. I can remember some passages that seemed rather boring, describing parts of the tabernacle, colors of curtains, dimensions for the temple. If you want to know what the tabernacle or temple looked like, only look up one Bible dictionary. Because if you look it up in two Bible dictionaries, you'll find three photos. The words can be interpreted a variety of ways. And you know, colors all mean something. Dimensions mean something. That's because we don't have numbers in Hebrew. We only have letters. A is one, or A. B is two, C is three. And every number, 4, 7, 4, D, V, D. It's actually the seventh letter is F in English, but in Hebrew it's a V. 4, D, V, F, V, 4, V, D, V, D. David. And so, 6th letter is F, 464, means David, or it means 14. Matthew 1, there's three generations of 14 people in the genealogy of Jesus. Here's a way to remember, fully son of David, three groups of DVD. 14 also means David. See, so numbers can mean many more interesting things than just a number. Now, the city of Florence decided to have a contest for a statue of David that would serve as the symbol of Florence in the late 14, early 1500s. And as you know, Michelangelo's statue won. David is actually seems to be described for us in the book of 2 Samuel. He had a ruddy complexion, was short, and a pleasant face. He was scrawny, easily freckled in the sun, is what ruddy complexion means. Not like his big bronzed brothers. Michelangelo should have used a splotchy granite. Would he have won? Michelangelo's David is a combination of Zeus and Mercury, two Greek gods. It is amazing how well Michelangelo had studied the musculature and even sanded that to look like flesh and soft. As you see, he's looking across toward the enemy, Goliath. I guess that was the second one already. He did exaggerate the head and the hands. Let's go back. No, I thought he had two. He did exaggerate the size of the head and the hands compared to the rest of the body to make you think what David thought and what David did is important. But David, the Bible, was a little kid out in the wilderness with a few sheep. And when the prophet Samuel went to Bethlehem to choose who would be a great king, the population already chose a basketball player, Saul, from a town named Gibeah. Saul, remember, stood head and shoulders above the rest of the Israelites. And now for 40 days, Saul and his army are opposite Goliath, who stands head and shoulders above the Philistines. By the way, Philistine skeletons are Indo-European, 4 to 6 inches taller than the Semitic skeletons. So the Hebrews called them giants. And Saul was probably a pituitary giant among Goliath, a pituitary. Who should be in Saul's armor? Saul. And David went down to take some bread and cheese to his brothers, and he says, "Who is this uncircumcised Philistine defying the armies of the living God?" Shut up, kid. Shut up, kid. Remember, Saul offered his uniform, his armor, to David. David puts it on, can't move. The reason you need to know that David is short and squatty, and that Saul is head and shoulders above, is to understand something in the story. Probably he was a little kid this old. This is some shepherd boys near Bethlehem in the wilderness of Judea. Oh yeah, there's the other picture. But exaggerating the size of the head and the hands compared to the rest of the body. Let me show you a couple pictures of our altar at our museum and some jars, anointing jars, in our tomb replica. A Canaanite altar was made to look beautiful. Do you see there's what are called headers and stretchers that some head out toward you, some stretch across? And the four corners, called the horns of the altar, are nice curved quarter circles. It's beautiful, white stone. The Israelites are told when they make their altar, you must use field stones, stones as you find them in the field. And you should not have an iron pickaxe applied to any stone in the altar. It must be a natural stone. In 2005 and 2006, we hired two Mexicans from a mountainous village in Mexico who were used to chiseling stone, and I trained them in five different periods of stonework. But when we're making this altar, I took away their hammers, their picks, their chisels. And I joked, "And if I hear one pickaxe back to Mexico." They would look through a pile of rocks that we had, picturing a size stone that would fit. We did allow them to have a wooden mallet to tap the stones in. But there's nothing but the stones. You see the ramp leading up. They even found slightly horned stones. The Bible tells us why you're not to have squared stones, but only field stones. Listen, lest someone worship it. If you make the altar too beautiful, it can become an end in itself. And the function of the altar was to be a means to the ends of worshiping God, bringing a sacrifice there. At the same time, this is from 600 BC, we have an exhibit. Since I was with you 3 years ago, we've received 250 ancient artifacts from the Israel Antiquities Authority. Perhaps one of our news, I can show you some of those. We're really excited about it. We have a little brochure back there. We're the only seventh museum in the world to receive a collection. And the collection they gave us is larger than the six other museums together. And our little brochure said, what do the Louvre in Paris, the Metropolitan Museum of Art in New York City, and LaGrange, Georgia have in common? A collection of artifacts from the Israel Antiquities Authority. Now these are anointing jars from a tomb that was used in Jerusalem in 600 BC, the only unrobbed tomb from a wealthy tomb owner in Jerusalem. You see, they're very simple. They just have anointing oil, which means they're 2 or 3 inches high, and you use it to anoint the dead. Now, here, the same period in Greece, two anointing jars. Two anointing jars. Here you can see a front and a back of the picture of the same one. But look, a beautiful palmettus, a type of fanned-out palm branch. They're called lykithos jars. This one had human form on it. There's Penelope and Odysseus on the right. They're followed by Argon, their dog, on the left, which is why I was glad we could get this one. It has a dog on it. But Argos. But this is how anointing jars looked in Greece, the same period, 600 BC. Very different culture. How do you make it look beautiful? And in Egypt at the same time, we also have these. This is the front and side view. You see the hieroglyphics on the left one. This is a woman who has two hoes. They're black shaped, for kind of an A shape for working the fields, in her hands. And in the front it says in hieroglyphics, when you summons me, I will come. And wealthy people in Egypt buried 365 such statues. So you could be served by every day of the year in the world to come. But very different notions of what's appropriate burials in a tomb. This ugly statue is a furrowed brow, angry eyes, an open mouth. This is Mot, M-O-T. In Egypt, you would say Mut. It's the power of death. Mut is always pictured with an open mouth and an ugly face. In the Psalms, I shall not fear the jaws of death. You and I would say decomposition. Back in a pre-scientific era, you can imagine, you put a loved one in a tomb. A tomb is made to have a variety of people buried sequentially in it. And someone else in your family dies, you come back 2 years later and there's only skeletons. What happened to the flesh of your loved one? Mot devoured them. Mot was this Pac-Man who goes devouring everything in its path. But for the Hebrews, there is a God stronger than the jaws of Mot, the jaws of death, not to fear decomposition. May I wake you up with a second grade level joke? Fanny was visiting Beethoven's tomb. As they approached it, there was this little opening between two of the rocks, and a light was coming out. Curious, they got down on their knees and looked in. And there was Beethoven with his music spread out, and believe it or not, an eraser. Beethoven, what are you doing? Decomposing. Maybe that's even first grade, not second grade, or kindergarten, I don't know. Okay, let's go back to pages 19 through 25. God is like what God has done. There's some charts in your notebook at the back showing you that Greeks postulated arrows going up to God, what they would call the attributes of God. And the human level points to the God with adjectives: omniscient, omnipresent, omnipotent. The other chart shows arrows coming from the divine, pardon the three-decker universe for the dry, and there's people with arrows coming down, and God has self-disclosed in our geography, in our time, acts of God. A famous Old Testament scholar named George Ernest Wright chose to call the acts of God by periods all starting with the letter C, so you could remember them. Creation, covenant, Abraham, Sarah, the patriarchs and matriarchs. You then have the bondage in Egypt, and the Exodus, the commandments. You have then the coronation. God works through the kings. Even a sad chapter, the captivity. They come back from captivity without idols. The two easiest periods for an archaeologist to distinguish: before the captivity, idols everywhere. After, not yet one. That tragedy cured them of idolatry. We would add three from the New Testament standpoint: Christ, church, consummation. God's able to wrap things up. But these are ways God has disclosed in our world what God is like. So let's just take a few of those. We're going to go till 10 after 6. We advertise 5 to 6:30. And we'll see if there's, no, we'll give you 20 minutes. There's questions. If not, I'll throw in a few more pictures. But this imagery is mentioned on page 34 and also a chart in the back. If I asked you to write down on a piece of paper what was created on each of the 6 days of creation, you might be able to get a couple of them. After the next 3 minutes, you'll be able to, 10 years from now, if the Lord gives you 10, put down the 6 days of creation. Because the ancient mind organizes these things in a ways easy to remember. Have you noticed the first 3 days of creation are general? Day 4, 5, 6 are specific in the same order. So if you can remember the three generals, you probably are going to be able to have 4, 5, and 6. Three specific. Day 1, light. Let there be light. Day 2, the firmament, the clouds above the air, and the waters below. That's day 2. Day 3, we have dry land and plants. It's called the twice good day. Every day says it was good once. Day 3, pamaim tov, the twice good day. And that's the day you're supposed to have a wedding. So there's good luck for the bride and good luck for the groom. You have any traditional Jewish friends, you ask them when they got married, they say Tuesday night, the twice good day. Are you ready for John chapter 2? On the third day, Jesus went to a wedding feast in Cana. Doesn't mean on the third day after what? On the day of weddings, the twice good day. And Mary, remember, was in charge of the servants at that wedding at Cana. Okay, there's the three generals. Remember, there was light, the waters above, clouds, the waters below, and then dry land and plants. So day four, it's going to be sun, moon, and stars. That's the specifics of light. Isn't it interesting? For those tempted to think of this as sequential, the plants were before sun, right? It's a poem. Three generals. So days four is sun, moon, and stars. Did I press that? How come this is happening? Day five is the birds for the clouds above and the fish. That's the waters above. And what was day three? Dry land and plants, remember? So we have animals and humans. This is a little Byzantine period icon. It looks like Eve is tugging a little bit on Adam's fig leaf. It's not fair that only women were pictured as temptresses. I imagine Adam might have been interested in Eve's fig leaf as well. You heard what Adam said to Eve, didn't you? A clean Adam and Eve joke. There is at least one. All right, Eve, this is the last time I'm going to tell you, quit tossing my pants in with the salad. I'm sorry. Maybe you wanted a different dressing. Jim, okay, let's go back to serious lectures. Let's think not only what the sea looks like, your notebook treats this on page 35 to 36, but for the ancient mind, what does it do and what does it mean? So I'm trying to have you get out of your modern skin and think back like the ancient would, the sea. The word sea is Y-A-M, yam. It's also the word for chaos. In Genesis 1, the Lord's Spirit brooded over the chaos of the sea and caused dry land to appear. Landed people, particularly desert people, were afraid of the sea. Particularly a storm at sea. And so the sea was the word for chaos. The northern coast of Israel lower whenever there's an earthquake, and therefore the sea erodes into the shore, like you see here. There's even some towns 400 yards out into the sea underwater, because with earthquakes, the northern coast of Israel is an irregular coast. The U.S. coast on the east is irregular, so you have it lowers. The west coast rises, so it's smooth. The southern coast of Israel rises. There's coastlines further inland in the south. They were afraid that one day the sea would cover the land. So the Psalms say, don't worry, the Lord holds up the pillars of the shore. But it's not only the rain and the flood narrative in Genesis. The fountains of the deep were broken up. So they were afraid of the sea. It was chaos. Even the Sea of Galilee, though it's only 7 miles wide, 12 miles long, you would call it a lake. But we only have one word for body of water in Hebrew. Med, dead, red, Sea of Galilee. A natural body of water is a yam. We have another word, pool, for an artificial body of water, a bit of cut or artificial. But the even though it's only 7 by 12 miles, did you know in a 45-minute period you can get 8 to 12-foot waves in the Sea of Galilee if a storm comes? Chaos breaks. Here you can see the clouds show streaking winds rushing across the sea, the waves beginning to build, an art for the storm at sea. It looks like you might imagine a Mediterranean storm, but you can have very severe storms at the Sea of Galilee. Now, this map at our museum is painted according to rainfall. Did you know that rainfall is pointed according to depth? Did you know there are places the Mediterranean is 6,000 feet deep? So it's the great and scary sea. No anchor ever had that much rope. So in the ancient mind, the Mediterranean was bottomless. Now, can you imagine being in a wooden boat, not a metal cruise liner, in a metal boat, in a storm on the Red Sea or the Dead Sea? For all eternity, you would sink into a dark, trackless place. Did the hair go up on the back of your neck? Ancient people were afraid of the sea. The land, terra firma, you can see a path, footprints. The sea is trackless. So ancient people were afraid of the sea. Now there's two things that really ancient Hebrews were afraid of: the depths of the sea and the depths of the earth. The depths of the earth is a tomb carved into the earth. And these two fears are referred to in the book of Revelation. By the way, this is a coast of Syria, just north of Lebanon, called Ras Shamra. There's an archaeological site there called Ugarit. And this is a temple to Baal found there. And the word for death in, I remember it was mot, I told you, for Hebrew. It's also the Canaanite word for death. And yam, the word for sea, is also the Canaanite word for chaos. And before you go on a sea journey, you're going to try to go to a Baal temple, for there won't be a storm. He's the weather god. And we found in the Baal temple also an anchor. And hope there won't be a storm for the depths of the sea. Canaanite Bible has been found. There's three chapters. And the Canaanites are also afraid of the sea. And to appease Baal and Yam before you go on a sea journey. Baal, remember, is also the agriculture god, the god of the economy, who gives the rain. Mot visited us last night and this morning. The joy of bringing in your harvest. You thank Baal for your harvest. This is, we don't have real skeletons at our museum, but we have a curator who's very good making them look old and moldy. I'm going to get into trouble with my next sentence. You can tell this is a female burial because the mouth is open. Just a minute. Try not to be as dumb as I look. Had it been a male burial, the foot would be in the mouth. Is that equal time, I hope? Okay. In Verdi's Requiem Mass, Verdi had a Christian composer who died. Verdi himself struggled with faith. But he had such respect for this Christian composer, he got permission from the family to write a Requiem Mass. And he decided to write it to illustrate Revelation 20:13. And the sea gave up the dead in it. And the depths of the earth gave up the dead in them. The two main fears that people had. And in Verdi's Requiem Mass, the instruments actually sound like a storm and the waves crashing and a boat slowly sinking into the sea as this terrible storm comes across the land. You can just hear it coming. You can begin to feel the clouds coming over and then the waves mounting. And eventually you feel they are splashing into your boat and the boat begins to sink. And in Verdi's Mass, then the notes get lower and lower and quieter as it sinks into a dark, trackless place. Who would have thought Verdi then put in the Requiem Mass a single distant trumpet? You can barely hear it. And then a second trumpet, a bit louder. Then a third trumpet, but in discord. finally a fourth trumpet in strength of harmony, getting louder, and then our first human voices, and amen. God's outstretched arm can even penetrate the depths of the sea and the depths of the earth. So in the book of Revelation, that is showing God's victory over things that about which we would have great fear. But what I've tried to help you understand with a few illustrations is how you take things in our own word and ask what they look like and what they do for the ancients. But it's important for you to be in a time when ships were made out of wood and people were made out of iron. In our day, people were made out of wood and ships were made out of iron. So we go to the sea for a cruise or a vacation. But for the ancients, these were great fears. Let's take a few more images that relate to water. A stream, a well, a rock-cut plastered cistern, an aqueduct. At our museum, we have all four of these things to be able to talk more about the imagery of water. Now, of course, in the desert, and I think tomorrow we'll talk more about the life of the shepherd. In the desert, you try to camp near an oasis. Here we have a palm tree. We've made a little desert stream here. We had to bring in limestone from Alabama because 95% of the biblical sites are made out of limestone. We wanted to be accurate. And Georgia is taken for granite. And we didn't want to have Georgia granite in those. But here's our little stream. Since then, we've added papyrus and bulrushes. Some of you have seen Caesarea Philippi. This is the Jordan River flowing out of the cliff where Jesus, in the morning message, asked the disciples, "Who do people say that I am?" John the Baptist, Elijah, Jeremiah, one of the prophets. "Who do you say that I am?" was asked in the district of Caesarea Philippi. But a spring is water flowing from the ground, perhaps the side of a slope of a valley, flowing down in a stream in the valley bed. The word for it is living water, which means running water. And therefore, it's a symbol of grace and gift. It is free. It comes to you. Grace and gift is the imagery of a spring. A well, human effort. It's a symbol of work. You dig it. And in a series of drought, the water table might go down. You have to lower your well. Human effort and work. Here's a well and a watering trough at our museum. So quickly, the Samaritan woman. The village of Sychar is known, it's called Aksar today, and there's a 90-foot deep well nearby. Could go way back to the time of the New Testament. And it's 90 feet, you don't leave rope there. Each woman brings her own rope. Someone might steal your rope. And this is the only place in John's Gospel we really feel the humanity of Jesus. He's tired. It's 1 o'clock. Sitting on the well. And a woman of Samaria comes up, meaning she's bringing the rope and a jar. And Jesus asked her if she could help him have a drink. And she's surprised. "How is it that you, being a Jew, would ask a drink from me, a woman, that's bad, of Samaria, that's worse?" In the course of their conversation, remember, Jesus says, after saying thank you for the drink, he says, "If you drink of the water I offer, you shall have living water." And she makes the mistake of taking Jesus literally. "Oh, you'll take me to a spring so I don't have to schlep water," pardon me, a Yiddish word, she probably didn't say schlep water, "from this well anymore?" And in the course of the conversation, she understood Jesus was speaking of the grace of God, living water. That's a deep subject at that well. And that story in John helped the early church realize that Samaritans and women are worthy of theological discourse. And when Paul greets, we'll talk about that perhaps a little bit more later, when we talk about women in Islam in our noon sessions, but when Paul writes the book of Romans, he's in Corinth when he wrote, he gives greetings to 16 people in chapter 16. More than half are women, and the church in their house. And noteworthy teachers are first introduced the right way, Aquila and Priscilla. But she was the more noteworthy teacher, so every other time it says Priscilla and Aquila. So they became teachers in the early church. So a well is a symbol of effort. Here's a nice well and a watering trough. Cistern. Carve out a deep hole. Plaster it many times so it won't crack. Water then, in this particular cistern, would flow in the right-hand opening and exit over here. See the plastered wall. A broken cistern in Jeremiah's writing is a symbol of uselessness. Those who've left the God of Israel and started worshiping Baal, Jeremiah says of them, you've carved yourselves out cisterns, but they're broken cisterns. We would say today, your new faith in Baal won't hold water. So a cracked cistern is a symbol of uselessness. We've also made an aqueduct at our museum. This is a copy of one found near Capernaum. It was 90 feet long. We've made an artificial spring that flows into the aqueduct. Have I been pointing to this picture? Anyway, the spring is up here. Here's our channel. And the ground drops 9 feet, but far enough so there could be an 8-foot-tall water wheel at the far end of the aqueduct, which is a way of keeping it only dropping 2 inches. You could then have water flow and turn a water wheel. It only takes one of those troughs to have it full of water before the wheel starts turning. And it turns a grinding wheel, a millstone. We got a grinding stone from the Chattahoochee River, which is probably from the 1860s, probably for grinding corn. But here you see two aqueducts for water to flow through bedrock to a grinding wheel. Some of you have been to the land of Israel. This is the Caesarea Aqueduct. But some aqueducts are 2 or 3 stories high, crossing a deep valley to take water a long distance, as this one in Spain. I'm going to stop for a moment and see if we've got some questions, and if not, we'll do one more thing with God, not looking like a rock, but functioning as a rock. My friends, how about a clarification of something we've said? I know we began a little bit more with Greek art and architecture, and not only saying what things looked like, which was important to the Greeks and later the Romans, and later the Renaissance, but for the ancient mind, how do things look? Could we clarify something? It's also okay if it's from this morning that I could clarify. You're not supposed to be hesitant. Usually you need a few brave folks who don't mind asking a question. I'll affirm you no matter what the question is. Could someone like me to clarify something we discussed so far? Yes, please. Thank you. Good for you.
This morning you said something about...
Oh, wait a second. We have a journalist question now.
So this morning you said something about when people greeted each other in the ancient world, instead of saying hi, they would say something about the infinite being either defined or informed by the finite, and my brain got stuck on that one. So if you could elaborate.
I didn't mean to mess you up. I was having fun with the way in the Byzantine period, particularly the 4th through the 7th century before Islam. All of your conversations, you tried to make things metaphysical, symbolic, trying to speak about how things must be in God's world. And you have writings about the 23rd Psalm that instead of saying, "The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want," you would say, "The infinite conditions the operations of all finite." The infinite cause conditions the operations of all finite causes. "The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want." But it made it very abstract, you see, and philosophical. And it wasn't to many folks, particularly not trained in metaphysics, it meant the psalm was not meaningful to them. But you were taking it far too seriously for being the infinite cause conditions the operations of finite causes.
I just wanted to know what that meant.
That's probably what many Christians who became Muslims wanted to know as well. Another question. That was good. Yes, sir. Yeah, go ahead, ask the question again.
In your presentation today, you've been using the term BC a lot. Now there seems to be a school of thought that we refer to it as BCE. What was your, my interpretation of that is it's just another attempt to water down a certain aspect of Christianity. But maybe there's a different explanation that you could give regarding that.
First of all, I appreciate you wondering if maybe one thought is not correct, it might have more than one possibility. When I taught in Israel, most of my students, particularly in the guide school, were from Jewish or Muslim backgrounds. And it's considered less offensive to someone if you don't say before the Messiah or after the Messiah when you're dating. And particularly if a Christian would be sensitive to a Jew or a Muslim, to say before the common era, the common name for the present era, CE, before the common era. I remember in one of my classes at Hebrew University, a New York Jewish student interrupted me when I said BCE, before the common era. He said, "Dr. Fleming, is that spelled E-R-R-O-R or E-R-A? I assured him I meant E-R-A, the common name for the era. If some of my lectures were meant mainly to be also open to a Jewish audience, or included Muslims, I think it shows sensitivity, say, common era. But B-C-E and A-D, after the year of our Lord, both are fine. But for most scholars, it's simply an inclusive academic name. You're not embarrassed about the meaning of the coming of Christ and about its meaning for Christians, but you would not like to unnecessarily make someone feel that you are being insensitive to their tradition. And it's up to each person to choose whether they would use that or not. Yep. I saw another hand up here. Okay. I'm sorry, did that not?
Well, yeah, just to add to that. Mm-hmm. Please. Here.
Just as a follow-up, you know, I'm sure that a lot of people think that or feel that, you know, when we get to Christmas time, we're supposed to use the words Happy Holidays so we're not offending anybody anymore. Do you feel that, as a Christian, that we're becoming to the point where we're not trying to offend anyone, that we're really not anyone anymore?
Mm-hmm. If I know someone is not from a Christian background, I'm happy to say, because it might mean that Hanukkah is also nearby, to say Happy Holidays. But for me, you're going to maybe not like this, I'm not even offended with Xmas. Because X, the Chi, is the first letter of Christ. And it was very important for early Christians to show sensitivity to their Jewish brothers and sisters. Jews don't feel you should pronounce or even write God's full name, Yod He Vav He, YHWH in English. But it's okay to say YH or Y. And it means the whole name. So by using the first letter of Christ, the X, it meant to people the whole name. And it's not just an abbreviation where you're intending to leave out Christ's name, but the custom was the first letter also refers to the full name. So sometimes it's important to look at the origin of the customs. And again, Christians should feel, and particularly in a democratic country where they have rights of assembly, they should feel that there's special meaning for a Christian holiday for them and not feel that in any ways you're forced to water that down. But to realize that some people who's not Christian will have different views as to whether or not you would say happy holidays, season greetings, merry Christmas or not. Yes, up here? One of you? Here. Wait 1 second. The mic is coming.
Here we go. I was going to ask about icons. You go back to the comment that you made about icons and, you know, idolatry. Do we have, with the cross, some of the olive branches there, is that an icon? Is that by the...
An image or something?
Yes. Mm-hmm. Are we to not be using that through the eyes of the ancient biblical...
Yeah.
People.
Okay, so the question was for a symbol. We tossed before about the X being the first letter of Christ's name. It is interesting, did you know the cross was a symbol for Messiah before Christianity? The last letter of the Hebrew alphabet in the time of the Judges was shaped like a plus sign. It's called a Tav, T-A-V. In the time of the kings, it was shaped like an X. So it tends to wiggle a bit. The Dead Sea Scrolls, whenever there is a verse about end of days, you find in the margin the last letter of the alphabet for end of days. Remember, Jews have this day and that day. A verse about end time, when Messiah makes things right. So Greeks say from Alpha to Omega. We say from A to Z. Jews say from Aleph to Tav. And we find on some bone boxes, where a person's name was put, bone boxes are 37 BC to 70 AD. But some of them have just on the Mount of Olives, 36 of them have a Tav scratched on it, which means here lie these bones until that day, until end of days, when God will raise them again. When, according to Ezekiel, them dry bones will come to life again. So it's interesting, the Tav is a symbol for Messiah before Christianity. But Christians felt, particularly when there was persecution, you need to be careful identifying yourself as a Christian. And when you shake hands with someone, with your index finger, don't squeeze so hard. You could make a little cross in the palm of the person's hand, just as though your finger was a little bit irregular, as a secret way of identifying yourself as a believer. The first letter of Christ's name, and in Judaism, the symbolic name for end of days. So one of the reasons we use the cross is as a symbol for identification, but also he was crucified on a cross. And some crosses are shaped like X's. It's called the St. Andrew's cross. Some crosses are shaped like T's. Others like the traditional cross. But because he died on a cross, would also be a symbol. Do you know, equal to the cross in early Christian art in the catacombs is a shepherd carrying a lost sheep. It's as equal a common symbol as the cross. But these were felt to be okay, pointing to Christ. Now, when we start getting full volume art statues or paintings of the crucifixion, this will divide some Christians, just like it would have in the past. And what these are called the iconoclasts, icon image, clast breaker. And some Christians were image breakers. This movement was in the 700s AD. And we have Christian, Jewish, and Muslim image breakers who felt that any animal or human should not be permitted. Did you know we have some mosques with animals and humans in the mosaics on the walls? These were moderate Muslims who felt if you're not worshiping the image, it's okay. We have some Christian churches where Christians came through, and the mosaics on the floor that had an animal or human are all chiseled up. The image breakers came through. Many churches made a new floor just before the image breakers got there. That was just above it, that was purely geometric to not suffer the image breakers. When the Muslims got to Bethlehem, they found a mural painted on the front of the Church of the Nativity that showed the Magi bringing, the Persians. This is 613 AD, the Persians from modern-day Iran area came, and they got to Bethlehem, and the Magi were wearing Persian robes on the front of the Church of the Nativity. So they did not destroy the Church of the Nativity. And they did destroy most of the art and stole the relic of the, quote, true cross from the Church of the Holy Sepulchre. But in the arguments about whether images were appropriate or not, the image of the Persian-robed icons of the front of the Church Nativity saved the church. And those arguing that icons can't be that bad if they saved the church. But this became a lively discussion in the Byzantine period. And eventually, it was felt the iconoclasts, the image breakers, went too far. And the religious meaning of image was permitted in the church. Yes, tolerance, right. Again, we'll talk about this a little bit tomorrow at noon and the next noon. In fact, I'll show you some pictures I have of Palmyra, which a year ago, this last summer, suffered the image breakers of ISIS. My friends, please consider getting the yellow notebook. Again, you'll be able to follow because our pages will be numbered and our lectures tomorrow night and the next night. And I hope you can jot down a question we didn't have time to get to tonight. But I'll turn it back over to Chuck, is it? Or?
Yes, I'll okay. Wrap it up. Okay.
Sure.
Thank you. Sure. Let's share appreciation. Fleming. Great to have you here. We look forward if you can come tomorrow and to the other lectures coming up. Fascinating. I know you want to continue this dialogue among one another as well. I want to especially thank some people tonight who've been helping us out. Lisa Helms back there in Austin, back there in the sound booth, hospitality and sound tonight. I want to thank them. Gail and Larry back here at the book table if you'd like to stop by and purchase some of those books and resources. Let's share appreciation to them for coming out tonight. And we look forward to seeing you all tomorrow if you can come, noon and evening. Remember, we have the buffet at noon, the buffet in the evening. Also, we're not taking an offering tonight. Usually when two or three United Methodists are gathered together, we take an offering. But we do have a basket in the back there as you leave. If you want to make a donation to offset the costs of the lectures for the church, you can make a personal donation. But no cost for the lectures, $6 for the meals noon and evening tomorrow. So thank you all for coming. Share some fellowship with one another, and we'll see you tomorrow if we can. Thank you so much. God bless.
I'll hang around up here if any of you have a question. Yeah.